Hi, everyone, and welcome. Thanks for joining us for this live-streamed public dialogue on communion, Catholics, and public life. Where do we go from here? We're so grateful to have so many of you joining us today from around the country. Hello, Fairbanks, Alaska. We have more than 3,000 people registered in advance for this conversation. So we're 6 weeks out from the June meeting of the U.S. bishops, who at that meeting vigorously debated and then decided to proceed with a document on the mystery of the Eucharist in the life of the Church. Their discussion and debate has generated considerable conflict, confusion, and controversy, especially related to the question of communion for public officials. Today, we'll examine why this matter has affected so many Catholics so strongly, and we'll explore the choices facing the bishops, public officials, and the U.S. Catholic community as a whole. It's important to note at the outset that all today's participants hold much in common, and among those are two core beliefs. All agree on our responsibility to protect unborn children and uphold the sanctity of all life, and all agree on the sacredness and centrality of the Eucharist. The set of questions on the table today are about how best to advance those beliefs in our particular context right now. This conversation too often stays at a very abstract level. We're going to look at how best to advance our shared goals in the particular context we're in at this particular moment for our country and our church. We've deliberately invited leaders with differing roles and positions on the wisdom of a communion statement now, choosing people who've offered principled, constructive contributions to the discussion of where we are and where we should go. It's a remarkable group. Gretchen Crowe is an award-winning writer and photographer and the editorial director for periodicals at Our Sunday Visitor. She serves on the editorial board of OSV, which addressed the bewildering fear of Eucharistic consistency after the June bishops' meeting. Molly Wilson O'Reilly is an editor at large and columnist at Commonweal magazine. In The Atlantic, she recently wrote The Real Threat to American Catholicism, challenging the decision of the U.S. bishops in June. Bishop Kevin Rhodes is the bishop of Fort Wayne, South Bend, Indiana, and chair of the USCCB Committee on Doctrine. Bishop Rhodes has a leading role at the June 2021 meeting and will have a leading role in developing and presenting the document on the Eucharist at the November 2021 meeting. Cardinal Joseph Tobin is the Archbishop of Newark, New Jersey, and has also been appointed by Pope Francis to the Congregation for Bishops, as well as the Vatican's highest court. At the June meeting, he urged the bishops not to proceed with their proposed document in this way and at this time. And my colleague and co-director, John Carr, is the co-director of our initiative on Catholic social thought and public life here at Georgetown University. And he also served as the director of the Office of Justice, Peace, and Human Development at the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops for more than two decades. So please share your thoughts on social media using the hashtag GU Communion Dialogue and by tagging the initiative at GUCST Public Life on Twitter. We'll also have an opportunity for questions and answers later on, so please submit questions for the panelists by following the prompts that you'll see at the bottom of your screen. And of course, this isn't the only story in the Catholic news right now. Among other issues, two writers have acquired app data from an unknown source and based on that have alleged serious misconduct against a top official at the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, leading to his resignation. That's not the focus of our dialogue, but it is part of the larger and difficult context facing the U.S. Catholic community, and it will likely come up in our question period. So let's get started. We're glad to have Archbishop Christophe Pierre, the Papal Nuncio to the United States, join us to help set the tone for our conversation. He unfortunately couldn't be with us live today, but we'll play a recorded conversation I had with him just yesterday on the themes that he shared with the bishops in June. Archbishop Pierre, welcome, and thank you for joining the initiative's dialogue on Catholics, communion, and public life. Where do we go from here? You're Pope Francis's representative to the United States, and after a year of tremendous difficulty with a pandemic, racial reckoning, and division and hostility in our nation, and unfortunately in our church as well as so many other challenges, what are one or two key elements of the message you shared with the U.S. bishops at their June meeting on behalf of the Holy Father?
At the beginning of their plenary meetings, the bishop asked me, as representative of the Holy Father, to address them. And I consider this as an important gesture of communion. It is in the logic of synodality. The bishops have the responsibility to guide their people. And this will not be possible if they don't work, they do not work together. This is the meaning of the word synodos, synodality, and with the successor of Peter. And the first step is to listen to one another, to listen to the Pope, and be always open together to the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And in such context, I try myself, I tell you, it's quite a hard job, to discern. And the discernment is it's a key word for us. To the direction of the church should take to respond to the precise challenges of our time. And I don't do it only on my own. And I spend considerable time to listen, to understand the teaching, the vision of Pope Francis. It is clear that my intervention gives space to Pope Francis' analysis and messages. I try to quote him, to remind myself of what he said. And during the last 5 years of my presence in your country, I've become aware of the urgency for our church to concentrate on the announcement of the gospel, to have a basic evangelization, not so much ideas, notions, but to witness our faith and our relationship with the person of Jesus. In a way, we have to rebuild the foundation of our faith. This is the reason why I spoke in my intervention about starting from Christ. Our church should be the place where people will have a concrete possibility to have personal encounter with Christ. We need to become a church which goes forth to encounter and accompany the people where they are and in the situation imperfect where they are. We need to be witnesses as persons, as communities, so that the people may have the practical experience of encountering the Son of God. And God himself, through his witnesses, his disciples, his missionaries, you know these two words which are so important, disciples and missionaries. In the second point of my address, if you remember, I spoke about the method, encounter and dialogue.
Thank you so much. And at that June meeting, the U.S. bishops vigorously debated and then voted to proceed with a document on the Eucharist, which generated considerable concern and controversy. What happens in the U.S. church can affect the church around the world. What might be some implications of this document and the U.S. bishops' actions going forward for the universal church?
You told us the debate between bishops was quite vigorous. And thank God for that. I'm very happy to hear people discussing, you know, because they are quite involved. The shepherds, like the disciples of Jesus, have different perceptions, coming from their responsibility to announce the gospel to their own people. And the challenges are enormous. And the experience that to reach out their own people and to accomplish this task of educators of the faith, because this is what they are, it is not an easy one. By the way, this challenge is shared not only by the bishops, by the catechists, by the parents, the teachers, the politicians, etc. So the purpose of such education is conversion, so that we learn step by step. I think step by step is very important. We cannot achieve that in one day. We learn to adjust our existence to the presence of Christ, to his message, to the good news. He will free us from all kinds of resistances. But we know each one of us, we know that the resistances are very strong. So we need time for that. He will free us also from a lot of misunderstandings and help us to find the kind of coherence. You remember the name coherence was the key word, with the new life, which will make us free. Now, we could ask you questions. Who will achieve such daunting task? It will be the church. The church is the community of those who have been called by Christ, like the first disciples, and have accepted to be his witnesses in this world, this particular world, not a world of our dream. Such church is ourselves, in spite of our fragility, our incoherences. We are his witnesses and are sent to make new disciples. This church has been empowered by the presence of the Son of God, by the presence of His Spirit. We are His church. Now, and this is an important part in my opinion, we, as His church, become sacrament of God's presence in the human and historical reality. And as sacrament, because the church is a sacrament, you remember, Lumen Gentium, the Vatican II Council document, you know, as sacrament, the church offers the sacraments so that we may be accompanied in our growth along the path of our existence. Each sacrament has a precise role to play in our life. And the Eucharist is one of them, food for life. The peculiar responsibility of bishops is to help the church to be always faithful to this mission. And the bishops want us, and I think they are right in doing so, to understand the beauty, the power, but also the exigencies of the sacraments we receive, so that we may draw the benefits of the grace of God and help us to be converted. Obviously, and this is the difficulty, maybe this is also the problem, the discernment is quite delicate, because there is always the danger to be overwhelmed by the tensions, and we know these tensions are quite often ideological tensions, which may divide our society and our church. This is why we have heard about the risk of instrumentalization of the sacraments, and indeed of the Eucharist. How to remain firm, faithful to the message of the gospel, and avoid any kind of ideological war? Big question. I leave the answer to all the people who will debate about that.
Well, let's get to a particular question about that. Prior to the June meeting, Cardinal Luis Ladaria, the prefect for the Vatican's Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, wrote to the president of the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, urging the U.S. bishops to proceed with caution in their discussions and actions regarding Catholics in public office. Can you discuss what Cardinal Ladaria's letter said, what its import is, and the role of the Vatican in this process?
Well, you know, in my opinion, Cardinal Ladaria's letter had this particular aim. It was an invitation made to the bishops of the U.S. to work together. Actually, it was in like the Holy Father, synodality. The church, local and universal, is the body of Christ. To this church, and don't forget ourselves, the sacraments of salvation have been given to be administered, offered to the people. Such church should remain united. Of course, it is not a kind of artificial unity. But as a result of the synodal path, this is the reason of the letter of Cardinal Ladaria, to become the living witness of God's love in the world. This is why I said in my intervention that, if you remember, I will quote this small sentence, the starting point cannot be to shame the weak, but to propose the one who can strengthen us to overcome our weaknesses, especially through the sacraments of reconciliation and Eucharist. By the way, there is a link between the two. This is very important.
Well, thank you so much. And if we could just sum up briefly, what do you think Pope Francis' message is in our current context, both to the U.S. bishops and to U.S. Catholics more generally?
Well, if I may, you know, give my feeling about Pope Francis' vision, I am deeply convinced that today the people, especially the young people, have not had enough opportunity to experience a personal encounter with Christ. And if I may say so, this is the main concern of Pope Francis. From there, his insistence on the necessity of a church of witnesses to go forth to the method of encounter of dialogue. Exactly like the parents with their children. You know, if they are not really achieving their aim, they fail. Like the teachers with their students. You know, the teachers are lost today. They don't know what to say to their students. Like the shepherds with their flock. In my opinion, there is no other way.
Thank you so much for joining us, Archbishop Pierre.
Thank you. God bless you and have a good encounter with the people.
We're grateful to Archbishop Pierre for making time for us. He provided a strong foundation for our more specific discussion now by calling on us to try to be witnesses to our Catholic faith, remembering to pursue unity and dialogue and exercise discernment. And now we'll continue the conversation and try to add in a small way to that discernment. Bishop Rhodes, let's start with you. This summer, you find yourself at the center of U.S. Catholic public discussion, which you probably didn't ask for and probably never expected to be. But last winter, the USCCB's working group on President Biden passed on to your Committee on Doctrine their proposal for a USCCB statement on Eucharistic coherence. And after an extended debate at the June meeting, the U.S. bishops voted to proceed with such a document. And now you're the point person on that. Some people watching will know all of the ins and outs of that process and how we got here, and many others will not have kept up with it. Can you tell us a little bit about the goal of the document and why it's needed now, in your view, and the process to get here and the process going forward?
Thank you, Kim. Thanks for this opportunity. I think I would say the goal of the document is to contribute to the Eucharistic revival. As some would know, our conference, the USCCB, has a strategic plan from 2021 to 2024, and it's focused on the Eucharist. It's called Created Anew by the Body and Blood of Christ, Source of Our Healing and Hope. So really, we're striving to write a document that will contribute to a real Eucharistic revival in the church, in our nation, by highlighting the truth about the amazing gift that Jesus gave us on the night before he died, the importance of beauty and reverence in our celebration of this great mystery, and the wonderful graces that we receive in the Eucharist to grow in our Christian lives. So that's my hope. That's the hope of our committee. Now, regarding the process to get there, it's helpful, I think, to know a little bit about the history. After the working group on the new administration recommended to Archbishop Gomez a document on Eucharistic coherence, Archbishop Gomez asked me and the Doctrine Committee if we would be willing to prepare such a document, but one that would be a teaching document, you know, a catechetical kind of document that would focus more broadly on the Eucharist as the source and summit of our identity as Catholics. So we're really looking toward a revitalization of our Eucharistic identity. And it would be, as it were, a theological foundation for the Eucharistic Revival Project. So we've taken this broader approach, the Eucharist as a mystery to be believed, a mystery to be celebrated, and a mystery to be lived. And under lived, we would treat the issue of Eucharistic consistency, which, of course, this approach was approved by the body of bishops at the June meeting.
Thanks for that. And so based on this context and on statements and actions of some leading bishops leading up to that June meeting and bishop statements at the meeting itself, many people understandably believe this document will offer set guidelines for withholding communion from public figures who either don't support certain pro-life policies and laws or who support policies that expand rights to abortion. You've said that's not an accurate understanding of what's going on. Can you help us make sense of this? And can you affirm that this document will not establish a national policy on worthiness to receive communion?
The issue of withholding communion, the church already has a discipline regarding the reception of Holy Communion. There are two canons in the Code of Canon Law, canons 915 and 916. I think that what we'll do when we get to that part of the document is present the teaching behind that discipline. The document will not be establishing national norms or a national policy. I've said that many times. That's really beyond the scope of the document. It's really beyond our competence. I mean, we're the Doctrine Committee. We're not the Canonical Affairs Committee. And it would also be quite a lengthy and involved process, as Cardinal Ladaria's letter made clear. The document also, it's going to be addressed to all Catholics, not a particular person or a single issue in the part on Eucharistic consistency. We have things that we'll be looking at. For example, back in 2004, we had a statement of the USCCB, Catholics and Political Life. In 2006, we had another document, Happy Are Those Who Are Called to a Supper on Preparing to Receive Christ Worthily in the Eucharist. So certainly we'll be looking at those documents. Now, I can't really say now what the document will say about Eucharistic consistency because we haven't written it yet. But we're waiting also, it's important to point out, we're waiting to hear and receive the input from the regional meetings of bishops that are coming up. So hopefully that's helpful.
That's great. Are those regional meetings coming up in August? I mean, what's that, August? And then is the document produced after that? What's that?
Well, we can work on some of the document kind of preliminarily, but on some of these more sensitive issues under Eucharistic consistency, I think we're really going to wait until we hear back from the regional meetings, I think there's a deadline of the end of August.
Got it. Okay, thanks for that, Bishop Rhodes. Cardinal Tobin, let's turn to you. You're the Archbishop of Newark, New Jersey, and you've been appointed by Pope Francis to positions of significant responsibility. At the June meeting, you urged the bishops not to proceed with the proposed document in this way and at this time. What led you to that position? And what do you make of evidence showing a lack of understanding of Catholic teachings on the Eucharist among U.S. Catholics? Now that the bishops have voted to proceed, what are your hopes and concerns going forward?
Well, first, let me say that it's great to be on this panel. And as a Bishop Emeritus of the state of Indiana, I'm glad to be here with Kevin and with, of course, a representative of our Sunday visitor. I think one thing I've learned in 43 years as a priest is that preaching has two essential dynamics. One is what you say, and secondly is what they hear. And at times when I get feedback, I said, "Teachers, did I say that?" And it really doesn't matter by that point. They heard that. And if it's true in media, perception is reality. I think that there's something that when close to that when as bishop or bishops we try to teach or preach. Now the first point that led me to suggest a different way in June was that this document was born in some confusion, beginning with the statements made by individual bishops after the November election, followed closely by the announcement of a working group. To sort of negotiate our relationship with the new administration. It was said at the end of the Zoom meeting in November of 2020 that this is just following the pattern that happened 4 years before. And some of us recognized that that wasn't accurate because there was not a working group established after the election of 2016. A working group was formed more than a year later to deal with the administration on issues of immigration. So there was that initial confusion. Why the working group, you know, to sort of accompany this administration that was not quite off the ground yet. Secondly, I think that the letter that was issued at the around the inauguration by our president, Archbishop Gomez, gave additional characterization of what this letter was going to be at. About this document was going to be about. And finally, I think that I believe as bishops, our relationship with each other has to be a relationship of discernment, you know, where we try to listen in many different ways to how the Holy Spirit is speaking to the church today. I don't think the conditions of the pandemic allowed that. And I am absolutely convinced the 300 bishops on a single Zoom call is not a good opportunity for discernment. Now, granted, we're going to have the regional meetings now, and we can hope for the best there. But that, in a sort of a nutshell, is why I tried to propose a different way in June.
Thanks for that. And let's talk a little bit about your particular context. You lead one of the most diverse dioceses in the country. The people you served have suffered greatly from the pandemic. And also, you've had significant global experience as well. Help us understand this discussion in that context. What's been the reaction to this in your diocese and more broadly, and what's been the reaction around the world?
Well, I think that, the Archdiocese of Newark, if we had been a country, the four counties that I serve with 1.5 million Catholics, if we had been a country in early spring last year, we would have been the fifth in terms of deaths and infections. And we still are leading the nation, I believe, in per capita deaths. So the people are, this affected our relationship with the Eucharist in extreme ways. Not only were we separated as the body of Christ, we were separated also from the sacramental presence of the body of Christ. And just tragic situations where people couldn't bury their dead in the way that they were expected to be able to do at the church. So it led us to a lot of reflection, and I offered a pastoral letter that I can speak about at a later moment earlier this year to try and get us thinking about why come back to the Eucharist. I also know that worldwide, the situation continues to be very dire, and I don't think anybody is unaware of that, so there's no need to elaborate. I think one of the most poignant liturgies I've ever seen was on the Friday before Holy Week last year when our Holy Father was alone. I've never seen that, working 21 years in Rome in one capacity or another. Never seen that. So, I think that the Eucharist is on everybody's mind.
Well, and that image, I think, is one of the most iconic images I think of from the pandemic of Pope Francis standing alone in St. Peter's Square and echoing the call to be not afraid. And I agree with you there. Gretchen, I want to turn to you now. You and your colleagues at our Sunday Visitor editorialized that much of the fear and division about all of this was misplaced and unfounded. You supported the bishops going forward. Share your perspective with us and that of your colleagues. What brought you and your colleagues to that conclusion, and what would you say to those who fear that this will further divide our church?
Thank you so much, Kim, for the opportunity to be a part of this conversation, to be here to represent our Sunday Visitor, which has for more than 100 years been in service to the church in a variety of ways. Let me address your last question first, if I may, about division within the church. And because that's something that's very dear to my heart as someone who's worked in the church in one manner or another in the past 20 years. We at OSV, of course, are highly aware of the painful divisions within the church these days. In fact, it's part of our charism, it's part of our mission to speak the truth in charity in a way that unites, to be a uniting voice around Jesus Christ, to help the church get where it needs to be. That being said, though, in my mind, a fear of division, or really a fear of anything else, really, never should prevent the church from teaching what it professes about anything, much less what it teaches about the real presence of Jesus Christ in the Eucharist. So that's kind of fundamentally, I think, behind what we were trying to say in our editorial. But of course, from the first moments that we at OSV started hearing conversation around a document on the Eucharist, it made sense to us. I mean, we're in the media business. We follow the news like everybody else. We know of the Pew survey that came out a few years ago with those really I might say horrifying numbers of people who did not, who regard the Eucharist as a symbol rather than regard it as the real presence of Jesus Christ. Furthermore, as Catholics, we are witnessing people leaving the faith. We're witnessing the emptying of pews. We're understanding that there's a lack of real belief in what the church teaches. I mean, that's what people say when they leave the church often. It's because I don't agree with it. So we're at the real, we're at a real problem, I think, of catechesis. I'm not saying anything new. This is, I think, well known, well documented. But people don't know what the church teaches and what the church teaches and why. I might also add that I think people are confused. It's been a rough 20 years for Catholics. Again, I'm not saying anything that you all don't know or that anyone watching doesn't know. And then we've got Catholics in very public positions who are actively working against what the church teaches on some of its most fundamental beliefs. So, I mean, Catholics, I think, are left wondering, well, what does this mean? You know, does being Catholic mean anything anymore? Or is it just one of the labels that we can put on and take off at will, you know, in our 21st century reality? You know, that the fact that the faith, I think, is not compelling is a tragedy, given that we have what should be the most compelling thing of all, Jesus Christ himself, truly present in the Eucharist, available to us in the most intimate way every single day. So I think that when our perspective was that it was hard to hear that some in church leadership would so strongly object to what we saw as encouraging Catholics to live what they believe. You know, we hear a lot about the source and summit of the Eucharist. Do we reflect really on what that means? That everything comes from it, everything moves towards it. You know, in our minds, if Catholics are afraid to speak out boldly on this fundamental truth, including on the action that living the Eucharistic life demands, you know, what does it mean to be a disciple of Jesus Christ then?
I hear you on all that. And let me ask you, in light of that, what do you think should happen in November? What should the bishops be saying and doing right now? And what should they do in November? Will their statement in November help advance those worthy goals?
Yeah, I mean, I think absolutely. I think anytime the bishops take a clear stand on what the church teaches, particularly around the Eucharist, I think it can really help in terms of catechesis. And that's really encouraging. It's one of the reasons why we support this document. You know, and also, you know, I know that the Catholics in the pew are looking to the bishops in December to be pastors. They're looking to them with the expectation of spiritual and moral leadership in this time. And there's nothing more basic than the church's teaching on the Eucharist. There's no better way, I think, that our bishops can be our leaders, our pastors, than to help communicate what the church teaches on the Eucharist.
Thanks for that, Gretchen. Molly, let's turn to you. You and your colleagues at Commonweal as well have had different perspectives. You wrote in The Atlantic that using the Eucharist as a partisan tool seems anything but coherent. Can you share your perspective from that Atlantic article with us? And what would you say to those who hold that a document reaffirming the meaning of the Eucharist in the life of the church is sorely needed, and that the church needs a strong public response to the fact that President Biden and almost all Democratic officials oppose the Hyde Amendment and restrictions on the destruction of human life?
I think I would say, first of all, that those needs seem to me to be two different things. I think a document on the mystery of the Eucharist in the life of the church sounds wonderful. It doesn't seem obvious to me that that document would have to end up talking about the centrality of abortion in American Catholic political life. I worry that a strong response, as you said, on abortion or to Biden and other politicians who favor legal abortion will translate to a simplistic response. Because it does seem to me simplistic to say that abortion is the preeminent priority for Catholics politically, not just in a sense of ranking moral issues, but also when it comes to making specific decisions about voting and about elections. And insisting on that has led the Catholic Church and the Catholic hierarchy into a de facto alliance with the GOP over the last several decades. And I know the response to that is like, well, that's the Democrats' fault. You know, nobody's making them be pro-choice. And I think that's fair. And I do want to see the Democratic Party pushed on these issues. But I also want to see the Catholic Church take more responsibility for the negative consequences of that alliance and of that kind of single issue focus. To me, the 2016 election was almost a farcical illustration of what happens when you do follow that path for long enough, that you get to a point where you are saying Catholics need to support the pro-life candidate and the Republican Party, even when that means you're telling them to vote to put Donald Trump in charge of the country. And the negative consequences of success in that campaign have been overwhelming. So what I hope to see in following that election, if not leading up to it, was a kind of reckoning with that, that this is, how did we get here? How a reevaluating of how laying out priorities this way led us to a point where Donald Trump was becoming the president. And I did hope to see after his election a greater pushback. That would have seemed an opportunity to me when a working group to confront what are we supposed to do with this president might have been appropriate. But as Cardinal Tobin said, we didn't see a working group like that. And the pushback that we did see tended to be fairly muted and easy to ignore. Meanwhile, there were bishops who were very happy, I think, to be seen as in alliance with Republicans who were in power as part of this new power structure. So to me, that was very compromising to the church's witness. And now that we have Biden in office, and we are still dealing with so many of the negative consequences of letting someone like Donald Trump be in power, to me, the most significant thing about Biden is not his position on abortion or even his identity as a Catholic, but just the fact that he's the guy who has the job of trying to fix all of these messes. And for the bishops to come out on what looks like a kind of a war footing against him on the issue of abortion is disappointing, because I think this is an opportunity when the church could really be a fruitful partner in addressing a lot of those other issues that so badly need to be addressed, and where I think there is a lot of common ground and common language. I don't think that that means the bishops can't also be clear about the differences on the issue of abortion, but I don't think that Catholics are that confused about what the church teaches. And so I worry that we still haven't learned our lesson about the consequences of this single issue focus.
Let me ask you this just to follow up. What should the bishops be saying and doing at this moment in our particular context? And what should they do in November? What would you like to see from them then?
I am, when it comes to this document, I mean, I certainly think because of the pandemic in particular, but also because of the Pew survey that Gretchen was talking about, and you know, the people falling away from practice, I think appealing to people on the basis of the Eucharist makes a lot of sense to me. But I think attaching it to politics and attaching it to abortion doesn't really, both because I think it is polarizing, and also because I think it misrepresents the way that discernment and prudence and judgment enter into Catholics active in public life. That we can start by assenting to the sanctity of human life and the need to protect it. And I think that's not a hard sell for a lot of Catholics. But when you try to get much more specific before you let people in the doors, I think people don't come in the doors.
Thanks for that, Molly. John, let's turn to you. You've had a long history on these matters with almost 20 years at the U.S. Bishops' Conference, decades more serving the church. I believe you were in the room when they first voted on communion and Catholic politicians in 2004. So what's your take on what we've heard so far and on the issue in general?
Well, I'm sort of an insider and an outsider in that I have worked for the bishops a long time. I have enormous sympathy for Bishop Rhodes has been asked to do. It seems Cardinal Tobin talked about where this came from, the working group, the inauguration statement, and then they said, we have a mess on our hands. You ought to fix this, Bishop Rhodes. You're a really wise person, and you won't need it, but there should be no time in purgatory for you if this summer is any test. I think it's important to be candid about the differences here. How did the Eucharist, which is the sign of unity at our parish, in our lives, in our church, somehow become the thing we fight about in terms of politics? It seems to me we've gotten ourselves in a terrible place. I think this is the most dangerous, delicate task I think the conference has dealt with in my 40 years of watching and being a part of it. We ought to just say that this is not what we do. This is not who we are. In Asia, in Europe, in Africa, in Latin America, in Canada, in most of the United States, almost all the dioceses of the United States, in Rome, at the Vatican, we do not withhold the Eucharist from public officials because of their public stances. And so this has, I think, taken the divisions in the church and made it worse. Some people are thrilled. It's about time. Here we have a Catholic president who's bought the extremism of the Democratic Party on abortion. We ought to do something. There has been a relentless campaign among some bishops with their own statements and leaking documents and making the case. And then there's been a lot of pushback from ordinary folks and from bishops. I think I'm one of those who pushed back against the original proposal. I think it exacerbates our ecclesial divisions among the bishops. We saw that among the people, between us and Pope Francis. I think the pastoral dimensions of this are really serious. This is terrible timing. And as people have said, in the midst of a pandemic, racial reckoning, let's have a fight about whether the president ought to be able to receive communion. And publicly, this is showcases our divisions and is a diversion. We should spend our time talking about the humanity of the unborn child and of all life, rather than fighting about whether the second Catholic president ought to be able to go to communion.
Thanks, John. Thanks for that. Well, how about your perspective on what we should do now? You're a lay leader. You're a longtime USCCB official. What advice do you have for the committee drafting this, for U.S. bishops in general, as they get to November and at that November meeting?
Well, the advice you always get, the two bishops will see that they say it should be really short. And I have three things I'd like to add to the draft. I have tremendous ideas that you ought to incorporate while you make it really short. Of course, they're focused on purpose. And I think what Bishop Rhodes said, I am really happy to hear some of the clarifications and an attempt to overcome the confusion. Bishop Rhodes is the right guy in the right place to do this. But the statement ought to be clear what this is and what this is not in the document itself. Secondly, it ought to be clear who this is for, people in the pew. If I were to pick, this is for pastors and parents, not for bloggers and activists. The tone is really important. We have been through a lot in our church, and we have not been together for Eucharist. So this ought to be an inviting, not a lecturing tone, not a hectoring tone. We ought to be saying to people, the Eucharist brings us together. We need you as a part of our family of faith. And that means, I think, two things, and this is probably too blunt. We really ought to avoid the pick-a-pope Catholicism that we've developed, which I'm a Pope Francis Catholic or I'm a John Paul II Catholic. The Eucharist, care for the poor, defense of the unborn, resisting the throwaway society, unite Pope John Paul II, Pope Benedict and Francis, and we ought to be clear about that. I think the throwaway society is a great metaphor. And finally, we ought to use language that helps us communicate. In my parish, only a few of us know what Eucharistic consistency or coherence is. Most of us don't know anything about that. But those of us who've heard about it, those are now fighting words. They have become partisan code words. And so we ought to find a way to talk about living the Eucharist every day for everyone, for parents, for business leaders, for workers, and yes, for politicians and the rest of us. And finally, we ought to read the signs of the times. We're in a particular moment, and we ought to do everything we can to make sure the Eucharist doesn't get misused for political or ideological purposes.
Thanks, John. Thanks so much for that. And thanks to you all. And we're getting so many questions in that I want to just start to get to them right now. Bishop Rhodes, I'm going to start with you on this one, but anyone else who wants to jump in after that, please let me know. And I'll just say, I admire many bishops myself, and like many other lay people, though, and many people writing in, as I watched the June debate, I was struck by the fact that this very important conversation was only taking place among older, ordained, mostly white men. It seems like so much of this conversation is about bishops, but who has not been at the table in these discussions and in this decision-making process? How does that affect the discussion, and how can we help get those voices heard? Bishop Rhodes, can you start us off with that?
Thank you, Kim. And thank you, John. I appreciate your remarks. Just an example, last night, I had theology on tap with about 100 young adults in South Bend on the Eucharist. And I asked them what they would like to see included in the document. I think it's important that we bishops listen to our people. And I learned so much. I mean, so many great ideas came from our young adults. I think it's really important. And I think one focus that we have to always keep in mind is what the Eucharist is. And when we talk about consistency, it means consistency with the self-giving love of Jesus that's made present in the sacrifice of the Eucharist. And in any event, I do agree that we need to be listening. And last night was an example of where I've received some wonderful insights.
Molly, how about you? What's your perspective on that question?
Well, first, I guess I should observe as, and I'm sorry to say I had to have someone else point this out to me, but even this discussion here, it's all of us are white. And so it's a real challenge, I think, for the Catholic Church to actively try to make all voices heard and open up the floor for everyone's perspective to be heard in every place that we can. It's very easy to continue in our parishes and in all of our different contexts to not do that. But it's important, and I think we all need to be committed to it. And yeah, this is an issue. I mean, abortion is an issue, of course, that affects women uniquely. And so it is hard to see it being discussed as a political matter only among men. I'm not sure what the solution to that is when it comes to the bishop conference issuing a statement. But certainly if the statement is going to be about bringing people back to the Eucharist, then listening to people is really important. And I think listening to people beyond just the numbers in a survey like the Pew one, which I think could be misrepresenting the way that people understand the Eucharist, or you know, maybe people found the questions confusing, but the reasons why people haven't been at Mass are really complicated, especially because of the pandemic. And so the message that I think brings people back has to be similarly capacious. I can't just assume that people just need to be told more forcefully that Jesus is truly present in the Eucharist, and then they'll start showing up again.
Thanks for that, Molly. And a point well taken, by the way. You know, we've really tried hard over the past year in particular, and before that as well, to make our panels as diverse as possible, to have as many voices as we can at our table. We've had over 45% people of color as a part of our dialogues. And at the same time, there's always more to be done. And in this conversation, it's a particular challenge. And maybe Cardinal Tobin, you could help us round that out. Recognizing the diversity within the Latino and Black church, and particularly within your own diocese, when you look at the diverse diocese that you help lead, how does this issue affect those communities from your perspective?
Well, let me come at it a couple of different ways. First, the Latinos are leading the way back to the Eucharist. There's no doubt about that in the Archdiocese of Newark. And having listened to diocesan representatives in the Encuentro process, this grassroots synodal way, if you will, that was concluded formally in the autumn of 2008, but there's been an afterglow that's been going on ever since. These diocesan representatives say that their Latino communities are returning, and they are showing us a particular reverence for the Eucharist. I think it is a challenge for a bishop to listen, not simply to an opinion poll. I think if Pope Francis's great encyclicals were quoted as often as that Pew statistic, I think we might be better off as a church. I would question with the Archbishop of Miami, Tom Wenske, whether this is the best way to determine the sounding, the real opinion of the Catholic community in this country. Two other points that I would just offer, and one relates to something that John brought about listening to other countries and other bishops' conferences, which was a specific request of the Ladaria letter. I think there's a great value in that, not simply because the American conference affects others, but we also can learn from them, and including nations where there is a majority of Catholics and where, unfortunately and tragically, legislation has been approved to expand access to abortion. I recently spoke at the end of April to a former member of the Argentinian Bishops' Conference. And if you've been following things, they recently enacted their legislature a rather broad access to abortion. I said, what are the bishops doing? And I was told, well, they are certainly announcing the Catholic teaching on abortion, of which there is no doubt, I don't think. And anyone who's confused about it, I think, just needs to listen a little better. However, they're not invoking canonical sanctions against politicians or legislators. Well, then, are they slacking? Or are do they have a different pastoral sense? I mean, even some of my brothers have discovered the Aparecida document, which is an excellent, excellent piece of work. And it goes beyond paragraph 436, which is quoted often about Eucharistic coherence among political leaders. I would say, first, you got to look at that paragraph in the wider context of the document. And my second question is, okay, what are those bishops that met in Aparecida in the Continental Congress of Episcopal Conferences, what are they doing in the wake of that document regarding this important issue?
Thanks so much for that, Cardinal Tobin. Gretchen, and then maybe John, I'd love to come to you with this next question. We all know that the blowback against the U.S. bishop's decision to move forward with this statement was very strong. I have one question asking, is the church prepared for the mass exodus that will happen if President Biden is denied communion? And other questions saying, how do we better teach about the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist? So what's your reaction to those who blame, on the one hand, U.S. bishops who seem to be campaigning for such a document, and the other, people who blame the media for all of this conflict and controversy? I was the spokesperson for the U.S. bishops, president of the U.S. Bishops Conference, and I know there's this reflexive impulse sometimes to blame the media, who have often been such a source of important stories and transparency for us. So can you let us know a little bit about your perspective on that question?
Yeah, I mean, I think that this is a question of again, clarity of church teaching. And I think that's why this document is so important. I think the media, sometimes does get it wrong, and say that as a representative of the media, it's just a reality. But I think the media, as are the bishops, are often a really easy target or a really easy scapegoat for the reality that, that sometimes the church has to really grapple with some serious issues. In this case, a lack of people understanding what the church teaches, a lack of people leaving the pews. So, I think that the church really has an important challenge in front of us that we should embrace, trying to help people understand the real presence of the Eucharist, that it's easy to kind of put it off on a media fight or a political fight or what have you, or a fight among bishops, but it kind of misses the point, that misses the heart of really what we need to be getting back to, which is that there is this lack of understanding of what the church teaches on the real presence. And I'm just going to keep saying it because I think that's really what's key here, what's at heart here for our church, and what's the most important thing is then what does it mean to live a Eucharistic life, and how does that affect how we act? How does that affect our conversion, our call to holiness, all of that? So I think those are easy scapegoats, but I think it also diverts from the real issue at hand.
Thanks for that, Gretchen. How about you, John? What's your take of the source of the problem here? Is it some bishops? Is it the media? Is it something else?
Well, it's easy to blame the media. In this case, I think it's unfair. There were three stories. There are three stories here. One is where this came from. There was a working group. There was an inauguration statement. There was a proposal for a statement about Eucharistic coherence, focused on politicians who are in conflict with church teaching on abortion. There was a letter to the Vatican saying, tell us what we ought to know about that. And all that was reported. There was a campaign to make the case that the president ought to be denied communion. There were leaked documents, all that played out in the media. Then there was this remarkable discussion on Zoom, and there was serious disagreement. And Bishop Rhodes tried to clarify what this was, what this was not. And others said, that's not good enough. And others said, no, we really need to do something about the president. I don't think any media officials made up any of those quotes. And now the story is, so what's going to happen? I think the Doctrine Committee rightly is listening carefully, trying to figure out the best way, in the words of Cardinal Ladaria, to unite the bishops and to unite the church. And they will report what comes forth. But then there are going to be amendments, you know, to go this direction or that or directions. The divisions that have been revealed by this are real. My daughter, who I've spent my whole life trying to keep my kids close to the church, you know, with mixed success, candidly. In the middle of all this, my daughter says to me, if President Biden can't go to communion, then I guess I can't go to communion either. Lay off. Every parent who tries to keep their kids close to the church is struggling with this. Somebody said to me, if President Biden can't receive the Eucharist, how come Archbishop Vigano can celebrate the Eucharist? We need to get the Eucharist out of our point scoring battles. The Eucharist should be where we come together. Frankly, we ought to be saying, welcome home. We're a family. We've missed each other. We've missed the Eucharist, and we ought to draw strength in times of trouble.
Thanks for that, John. And Bishop Rhodes, maybe I'll follow up with you on that. Do you think such a statement coming in November advances the cause of evangelization for young people, advances the cause of our pro-life cause? Or do you think that because of everything surrounding this and the issues that have been identified today, it might set those important goals back?
My hope is that we'll be able to move forward and it will help the cause of evangelization. You know, one of the, in the silver lining in all the debate and disagreement, I think, is it makes people think about the social implications of the Eucharist, which I think is very important. I remember Pope St. John Paul II, but also Pope Benedict and Pope Francis. They all have written beautifully about the social implications of the Eucharist, that we can't separate worship from our life, that we're called to give public witness to our faith, to bear witness. And that includes respecting and defending the life of every human person, including the unborn, including the refugee, including the frail elderly. So bearing witness to the gospel. So I think, and that's by our words, but also by our actions. That's what real Eucharistic consistency is, in my opinion. And that's worship pleasing to God. Otherwise, we're worshiping kind of like the Pharisees, and we're not living what we are professing at Mass. Now, none of us does that perfectly. We all are sinners. We have the sacrament of reconciliation. But the Eucharist educates us to love. I mean, the Catechism says that. Catechism also says the Eucharist commits us to the poor. You know, so I think we need to see the connection with life. And I think that's where the whole notion of Eucharistic consistency should be centered upon.
Thanks for that. Molly, maybe just one quick follow-up on that too. What do you, you're a parent, what do you think about the impact of this on parents' ability to bring their kids, hold their kids in the church, bring them back to the church? What do you think it means for pastors too?
I am a parent, and my kids are young enough that they're not aware of all this yet, but I struggle with it even myself. I'm certainly someone who I identify pretty closely with Joe Biden because I grew up in Scranton and I went to the same grade school in the same parish that he did. So I see a lot of my Catholic experience reflected in the way he talks about his faith and quotes from songs like On Eagle's Wings and things like that. So I identify with what John was saying, that his daughter said, that, you know, if Joe Biden can't receive the Eucharist, then maybe I can't either. In a broader sense, when I look at, when I've seen defenses of, you know, making a firm connection between principles and positions on abortion and worthiness to receive the Eucharist, the scripture that I see quoted a lot is from St. Paul saying that when someone takes the body of Christ unworthily, that they eat their own condemnation, which is an important text in this context, but it also, quoting it, can feel like you're putting up caution tape across the sanctuary. And it's not an invitation. And the scripture that I would like to see more would focus on, I think it's from Isaiah, but if I'm wrong, someone smarter than me should correct me, but that everyone who's thirsty come to the water, and let everyone who's hungry come to the feast, and you know, see that this is the fulfilling food, that this is why are you spending your money on things that fail to satisfy? I think you need to bring people in before the Eucharist can start to work. Teach them to love, teach them to encounter, have that encounter with Jesus that Archbishop Pierre was saying about. And so if that's what we're trying to do, we have to be careful not to begin with the list of reasons that you might not be allowed to enter.
Thanks for that, Molly. Cardinal Tobin, I think this one, I'll go to you with this one. Many of our questions reflect frustration with our bishops, with priorities, not enough focus on issues of race or Trump on the one hand, a focus only on some issues. And on the other hand, people say, it's about time. You know, at what point do we call out public officials who are moving to more and more extreme positions on abortion, including our president? So frustration with priorities, frustration with leadership, frustrations with all of this going on. What's your response to that?
Well, I think we need to make a response. We need to be consistent. I would say, you know, the social dimension of the Eucharist begins when we receive it. I really like the formula used by St. Augustine in one of his homilies on the Eucharist, where he says, you hear the body of Christ. And interestingly enough, you don't hear, here is Jesus. You hear the body of Christ. And you answer, amen. So be the body of Christ, that your answer may be true. So the first witnessing to everything and justice in the world, but we witness first as a body of Christ. We are part of the same body. And we should be very concerned at anything that would allow the body of Christ to be fragmented and fractured. Because it's the opposite. The oldest prayer the church has around the Eucharist says, as bread scattered on the grain scattered on the hillside is brought into this one loaf and made one, so too we who share this become one. Now, I recently invited my archdiocese to join with me in strongly protesting the absence of the Hyde Amendment in the current proposed budget. This is wrong. This is a big mistake. And I'm wondering if how people that are calling for a canonical discipline against Catholic politicians have actually picked up their pen or their mouse and voiced their opposition. I hope every bishop has done that, as I have done together with my people. So it's not a disjunctive proposition. Either we threaten canonical sanctions, or we're blasé about the issue. No, the issue is life, and I would say in a continuum from conception to natural death. So it's not a question of dimming our witness, but it's how we do it. And always with the value of the unity of the body of Christ before our eyes.
Thanks so much for that, Cardinal Tobin. Gretchen, I'd love to come to you and have your perspective on anything you've heard so far, but also we're getting questions. And one, this is from Sydney Wooden at CNS, who asked that if Eucharistic consistency means living with love, why haven't any bishops talked about denying communion to politicians who support the death penalty or who enact anti-Christian migration policies? And we'll go to you after on that, John.
Sure. Well, I'll take, Cindy's question. I'll just give my perspective. As the bishops have made clear, abortion is the preeminent issue that the church is grappling with today. And so I think that's just kind of a really kind of simple answer that Bishop Rhodes or Cardinal Tobin could make better than I could. But certainly I think that's why this is such a focus. On the other hand, I would say, I also think the bishops are very clear about, the church's teaching on those issues. I think they have done a really good job, especially in recent years, of coming out with regular statements supporting or not supporting certain policy issues or what have you that are taking place in our conversation. So that would be my response to that. My only other thought was, Molly was talking about having small children. I certainly have two small children as well. And, as much I've been reflecting, as much as I support a teaching document on the Eucharist, and I think it's important, I've also been reflecting on the fact that my kids aren't going to learn about the real presence of Jesus Christ from a teaching document, no matter how wonderful it is. My kids are going to learn about the real presence of Jesus Christ from me, from my husband, from how we respond to the Eucharist, from how, our reverence in front of the Blessed Sacrament. And that's a real responsibility on the part of parents that I don't think can be missed today. And I think, hopefully what this document does is, as John mentioned, it helps inform the conversation for pastors, helps make them, encourage them to preach, which then gets down to the parent, which then helps them realize that it's their behavior, it's our behavior that really is going to influence this next generation of Catholics for a love of the Eucharist.
Thanks so much for that, Gretchen. And everybody, I think we're going to go just a few minutes over, not too long. We won't keep you too long, but we're having such a good conversation. I want to make sure to get as many of these questions in as I can. John, I'll go to you with this. First, your reaction to what we've just asked, Gretchen. And then our good friend, longtime USCCB leader, Ralph McLeod, asks that if the document will include the special and necessary emphasis on the Eucharist and its relationship and responsibilities to the poor, because as the Catechism states, the Eucharist commits us to the poor. So your reactions, first of all, on what Gretchen said, on maybe that perspective, then Bishop Rhodes, we're going to go to you with the same question. Thanks very much.
The fact that we're saying, why don't we deny communion to politicians who also demonize immigrants or act to end the life of prisoners, that's a statement of failure. Disciplinary actions, withholding communion, denying communion, means that we have not communicated our teaching in a way that engages and persuades. This is probably out of line, but I've known a lot of Catholic politicians. What makes Joe Biden different is not that he differs with Catholic teaching in some fundamental way. I'm bitterly disappointed that he's abandoned his pro-life stance in a number of areas. But what's different is he continues to be a part of our community. He's at Mass every Sunday. I don't think a Pope Francis Catholic, a Pope Benedict Catholic, a John Paul II Catholic, who buys the whole package, could be nominated in either political party for a major office. Abortion for the Democrats, immigrants, the death penalty for the Republicans. My problem with a lot of our Catholic politicians is they see conscience as a way to justify what they want to do anyway, to accede to what their party requires. And that's true of both parties. The seventh commandment, thou shalt not lie, is also a part of our teaching. And what I've found is they've frankly drifted away. And like a lot of Americans, politics has become a religion, and ideology is sort of where they draw their strength. We need to invite them back, not push them out. They need to be with us, see us for who we are, what we do. And when they do, they will see that the Eucharist commits us to the poor. they will see that in receiving the body of Christ, we commit ourselves to care for Jesus in disguise, in the hungry and the homeless. And therefore, we won't be seen as advocates of one issue. We won't be seen as narrow. We will be seen as contributors to the common good and an asset to the nation. But we need not to discipline politicians, but to engage our politicians and to pull them back in so they see the richness of our tradition in its everyday forms.
Thanks, John, for that. Bishop Rhodes, how about you? Your reaction to what you've heard? What about other issues like the death penalty in particular and immigration as well? And will this include a focus on the Eucharist connection to the poor?
Yeah, I mean, I spoke earlier about the social implications, and I think that is so important. It's so beautiful, connecting Eucharist to our life. But I think the one thing that I didn't say that I need to say that also pertains to Eucharistic consistency is that in order to be properly disposed to receive the Eucharist, we need to be in communion with the church, and we need to assent to the deposit of faith that's contained in scripture and tradition that the apostles entrusted to the church. This has always been, this is our perennial tradition. So Eucharistic consistency also involves our communion with the mystical body of Christ, the church. And that's what the Eucharistic body of Christ builds up. So I think that's important to keep in mind. And that's why the church has Canon 915, which says that one is not to be admitted to Holy Communion who obstinately persists in manifest grave sin. That's where this controversy, by the way, is really around Canon 915. But it seems to me that it's not talking about subjective guilt of persons in Canon 915, but the objective thing. And I think that's why it's so important that we make this connection between the mystical body of Christ, communion with the church, and the Eucharistic body of Christ, the Eucharist, which of course, builds the church.
Thanks so much, Bishop Rhodes. We've received some questions about stories based on two writers' acquisition and use of app data from an unknown source with their resulting allegations of serious misconduct against a top USCCB official leading to his resignation. They've now written two other stories, one about the Archdiocese of Newark and one about the Vatican. There's lots to say about this, of course, and we can't get to all of the issues today that surround it. But it does affect the US Catholic community and also the US Bishop Conference. Cardinal Tobin, I'd love to go to you to this. Your archdiocese was targeted by this. What's your reaction to these efforts? How do you think this all affects what's good, the USCCB and this document going forward?
Well, I think all of us as Catholics take promises. We make promises every time we renew the promises of our baptism. And then some of us, because of the call we felt in our life, either to ordained ministry, religious life, or marriage, the sacrament of marriage, we make other promises. We should keep our promises, and we should repent when we do not keep our promises. And we should not have situations that might encourage us to break our promises. I think pertinent to the reporters you mentioned, if someone who has made a promise of celibacy or a vow of chastity has a dating app on his or her phone, that is asking for trouble. And I would also say that I think there are very questionable ethics around the collection of this data of people who allegedly may have broken their promises. And the information that has been shared with the Archdiocese of Newark is very general. And I can't comment further on that. If there is more to be said, then either I think the best is to you can submit it under attorney-client privilege to our attorneys. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Cardinal Tobin. Just want to move on. It's obviously, Molly, I'd love to go to you with this, and then I'm going to come around and wrap up with everybody. Obviously, this is a very divisive topic, as we've talked about. I noted that Gretchen mentioned earlier that we shouldn't be afraid of division in some way. What's your reaction to that position? In other words, what's your reaction to how this conversation has gone, the tone of it? What would you like to see going forward? Is division around this expected? Are there things that we should fear worse than that, fear more than that? Can you talk a little bit about that issue?
I think that there are a lot of American Catholics who have gotten very comfortable with feeling like they are the right kind of Catholic and who want to keep hearing the bishops say things that make them keep feeling that way, and whose identity is built very much on identifying other people as the wrong kind of Catholic or not a Catholic. And I think that's a really toxic dynamic. And so if that's what we mean when we talk about division, then I do think we need to be concerned about it. I hear a lot about from priests and preachers saying, you know, we have to be careful that we always speak the truth and we always speak the church's teaching in clarity. But I think that that sometimes leads to a simplification again of the room for good faith differences of interpretation, differences of emphasis, and sometimes just good faith agreement, good faith struggle with disagreement, that is, good faith struggle with the church's teachings. And I think the impulse to come down hard on that and that's the work that the church needs to be doing is a mistake, and I think it's dangerous. So that's what I would like to see, more willingness to trust the Spirit to do its work. And I think as John was saying, the Eucharist is what brings us together, that we gather for the Eucharist. And if you can gather together a group of people who have a lot of different ways of thinking about this, and they get together to dedicate themselves to this prayer together to make Christ present among them together, that can start to do some of the work of making community instead of fortresses of different tribes. But again, I don't think that you can get to that point if you worry too much about what it will look like if you let all these different people come together to pray.
I couldn't agree with that more. In our work on overcoming polarization here at the Initiative, we have often said we're not looking for a least common denominator Catholicism at all. And at the same time, we've also often seen the Eucharist be a real source of unity for people. So I just want to go around the horn once real quickly and maybe in just one or two sentences to wrap up. Based on everything you've heard here today, and John, I'm going to start with you. What's the best path forward for the bishops in the U.S. Catholic Church right now?
Be pastors. Don't be chaplains to factions. Help us see what brings us together. Help us come out of a pandemic, all the loss of life, the economic stress. Help us see ourselves as one family of faith, united by the Eucharist, doing Christ's work, and invite people in. Don't push people away.
Gretchen?
I would say the best path forward is a clear communication that we have nothing to fear from the church's teaching on the Eucharist, and really that we have everything to gain from its full teaching.
Bishop Rhodes, how about you? What's the best path forward for bishops in the U.S. Church right now?
I think the best way forward is to continue to treat each other with respect, to move forward with charity, to remember that the Eucharist is the sacrament of charity, and that should not be lost in even when there are disagreements.
Thanks for that. How about you, Molly?
I want to say to trust lay people a little more. I think trust lay people to be able to discern, to receive the teaching and interpret it, and to respond to invitations, again, as John was saying, more than hectoring, to say, come back and do this project with us instead of get in line. I think that would help.
I couldn't agree more. But Cardinal Tobin, how about you? Based on where we are now, what's the best path forward for the bishops and U.S. Catholics?
You know, recently I purchased a book I had read 20 years ago called Paddy's Lament. And it was about what the famine did to the Irish families when a million people died and a million people emigrated. Because I'm anxious about knowing what will be the long-standing effects of what we've just been through and still are going through on our families, on our communities, and on the body politic. So I think what we need is a broader consultation with the American Church on the mystery of the Eucharist, and not one that, like it or not, is perceived as a political action. So I really would, we have a perfect invitation from our Holy Father to adopt a more synodal church, people who are talking together as we walk the same road. This, I think the consultation on the Eucharist could be broader, and it will result in a more useful document.
I think that's a great way to sort of points me towards something that Pope Francis just wrote in the middle of our current context, right, of a pandemic and division and hostility. He wrote this wonderful encyclical, Fratelli Tutti. And in it, he says, the church is a home with open doors, a church that serves and leaves home and goes forth from its places of worship, goes forth from its sacristies in order to accompany life and to sustain hope and to be a sign of unity, to sow seeds of reconciliation. I hope what we've done here today is a small step towards that, without eliding our real disagreements on some issues. And I really want to thank so much Gretchen, Molly, Bishop Rhodes, Cardinal Tobin, Archbishop Pierre, and John. And thanks all of you for joining us. Just a reminder that this discussion will be recorded and posted on our website and our social channels, and we'll have follow-up resources from the discussion posted there as well. Please be sure to visit our website soon to see our upcoming dialogues and gatherings for the fall 2021 semester. We hope to combine our virtual dialogues with their amazing reach. We have reached some 130,000 people around the country and the world in the past year, together with our in-person gatherings at Georgetown, which so much help us build relationships and solidarity and community within our local church here. So thanks to all of you as well who helped us on the technical end of this discussion, to my colleague, our wonderful colleague, Anna Misla, who helped make everything run so smoothly. And finally, please join me in thanking Archbishop Christophe Pierre, Gretchen Crowe, Molly Wilson O'Reilly, Bishop Kevin Rhodes, Cardinal Joseph Tobin, and John Carr for their participation in this dialogue. All best to all of you, and we look forward to you joining us again soon.